Welcome to today's program at the Commonwealth Club World Affairs, the nation's oldest and largest public affairs forum. Every year we present more than 450 forums on topics ranging across politics, business, society, climate and the economy. I'm Andrew Dudley, Chair of the People and Nature Forum, and it's a delight to see so many faces in the audience today. Now turning to our main event, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce Obi Kaufmann, author of several award-winning best-selling books on California's ecology, biodiversity and geography. His first book, The California Field Atlas, recontextualized popular ideas about what he calls California's more than human world. Obi was awarded a gold medal for his significant contribution to publishing by the Commonwealth Club of San Francisco.
In this room.
In this very room. So this was followed by his next books, The State of Water, The Forests of California, The Coast of California, The Deserts of California. Here we go. And most recently, The State of Fire, Why California Burns, which we're here to discuss this evening. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Obi.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Yeah. What an auspicious evening.
Yeah. So I'd like to start by asking you a little bit about your past, where you grew up and spent your formative years.
Just over the hill. I grew up, cut my teeth as a young naturalist on Mount Diablo, considering fire always as a core constituent of why that mountain looks the way that it looks. After that, I went to, before that, my father was the director of the Griffith Observatory down in Los Angeles. The astrophysicist, right? So I grew up appreciating this object of monumental beauty that is Mount Diablo, that I know intimately, like I know a dear relation. And yet at every day after school, it was hours of calculus homework with my dad. I mean, Dr. Kaufman's son was going to be a mathematician. I have more training in math than I do in art. That being said, I went to the University of California at Santa Barbara in the early 90s and studied art, most of the time skipping class and heading into the San Ynez Mountains looking for Chumash art sites and railing against the truisms that my father presented to me, such like, mathematics is the language of reality, is something that he would say. He's not wrong. Mm-hmm. And yet there's this whole aesthetic dimension. There's this whole half of, you know, the great schools of human thought that deserve and require consilience. This humanities and this physical sciences that when brought together form this entire unity of knowledge that continues to be the goal and aim of my work and these things that I produce. And you know, my father wrote textbooks with names like Discovering the Universe or Black Holes in Warped Space-Time, right? So I think, and this didn't occur to me until recently, he's been dead for almost 30 years, but it didn't occur to me until recently that he spent his life and his vocation figuring out what his relationship to the universe is. Mm-hmm. To whatever metaphorical ends that might satisfy his own criteria for some modicum of identity and solace in this phenomenological universe. And it turns out that I do the same thing. My symbol, my subject, my field of inquiry is a little bit more restrained. It's about 100 million acres of land area across the California floristic province and the deserts beyond. But still, I am looking for that universal citizenship inside of myself that is related to, I mean, if we could point out some sort of inherent paradoxes and hypocrisies and something like that, land acknowledgement that you just gave about the Ramatush and how you called us guests, which strikes me as a little disingenuous, shall we say, as if we're trying to write some cheap receipt for the injuries that may or may not be inflicted on this most precious of worldly biomes, this gorgeous California. How do I stand up in my own boots and finally be from this place. How does anyone be from anywhere? I was born here. My mother was born here. Her mother was born here. And yet I still feel like I'm colonizing this place. I still feel like I'm settling this place. I still feel like I'm colonizing my own mind. How do I stop colonizing my own mind? How do I identify with this core affection that I have for, as the past few weeks have realized, this most dangerous of all landscapes?
Did religion factor into your upbringing as a child, or was it more scientific?
Yeah, it's sort of startling to me how much it didn't. Mm-hmm. I grew up with no semblance of the thing, and it sparked this curiosity in me. I think if I hadn't been an art major, I probably would have gone into religious studies, thinking of greater epistemologies. How do we know what is true? Or greater ontologies. Why is there stuff at all, right? And yet I come back around to something like the astrophysicist Laplace, who in the court of Louis the 14th, when presented his orrery of the cosmos, was asked by the king, "But sir, where is God in this schema that you present?" And his reply was, "There's simply no requirement for that here." So I do feel, and this comes up a lot now in talks that I give on fire. It's funny, you know, I've been on book tour now for about 3 or 4 months with this thing. And in fact, book tour is kind of over. And lo and behold, look what happens. And yet here I am using the word covenant often, as if there is a broken covenant between humanity's relationship with California that is wholly pyrogenic in nature. California burns because of decisions that people make, and it has always been this way, at least for the past several dozen millennia. Mm-hmm. And discussing the nature of that covenant, that nature of societal relations with something that approximates even a religious context of this immortal body of California, I think is not without aesthetic value. And if the past 2 weeks have brought into focus clearly some ethical questions, it would be, what is the value of anything?
So what influenced your decision to start writing books?
Writing books. Did I make that decision? Sometimes in my darker moments, I think, did I write these things? Or did these things invent me to write them? Am I being manipulated by this by this body of knowledge that I supposedly birthed? So it starts with paintings, right? Like when I 2015, I was thinking about, you know, after decades of trying to find myself as a gallery artist and failing miserably again and again, how about if I just give it all away to the thing that I love most in this dim universe, the more than human world of California? I didn't know what the book was going to be. I just knew that it had to drip with color and soul on every page, just like I find across the California landscape, everywhere, color and soul and endemic processes that exist nowhere else on the planet. And so here I am, stumbling on this very simple idea: organize these biogeographies into cartographic semiotics, if you will. Talk about it rather academically, right? What are the symbols the symbolic language that we can use inside of the picture plane graphically to introduce and balance that consilient idea between the humanities and the physical sciences, to present the moment of rest, to present the moment of aesthetic satisfaction that also tends towards this data-driven requirement that I have, always with my father whispering in my ear about the nature of reality, that somehow there is a balance between all of this stuff that we feel and all of this stuff that we think. And now, therefore, myself, then, now identifying more as a poet than anything, even possibly more so than a writer or a painter, the poetry of the thing, I'm finding myself often as a science communicator, as a policy communicator, as a sometimes as something that approaches like a journalist and trying to tell this greater story of truth and tying that to meaning. As a poet, I'm licensed to do that. And there, if there's a spectrum of institutional thought on such things as ecology, it sort of moves through time from something like poetry. And I'm not talking about verse poetry or prose poetry. I'm talking about the vanguard of language in a cultural context. I'm talking about envisioning creative spaces and translating those spaces to one's community. It can be the poetry of teaching or the poetry of cooking, or certainly the poetry of painting. It's like what pushes then towards values that then emerge on the spectrum from poetry towards something like scientific investigation. Where do those values come from if not from poetry? Shelley reminded us at the beginning of the 20th century that poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world. And so moving from that sort of like core, like what is the stuff that we form these reasonable values from, moving them towards something like a scientific inquiry, and then moving that finally to something like a policy, something like a political application. So I'm over here, right? Most of the discourse, especially around these fires, is over here. Mm-hmm. What a interesting notion it would be if we could push the media this way, if we could push all of that stuff towards a holistic vision of what it means to be from California, what it means to have residency here, what it means to be part of this more than human community, what it means to have a nuanced conversation about the ecological realities of fire in California that will not go away despite how much Democrats and Republicans seem to like to blame each other.
Okay. Can you take us back to the very beginning, if time is even the right concept to use, and walk us through the evolution of fire and its connection to the great oxidation event?
Oh, wow, fantastic. The great oxidation, you want to go that far back?
A little bit.
sure. Okay, so the great oxidation event, okay. Let's see. World history of the biosphere in 35 seconds.
not that quick.
Right. Well, you know, I mean, we could think almost of like the biosphere. Well, you were asking me a temporal question, mm-hmm. right? Going back that far. If I may, I'd like to reframe it in sort of a spatial question. You can't, you know, remember we're living in the 21st century and you can't have space without time. And a lot of the times, especially as a cartographer, I like to express time in terms of space. So we can talk about the biosphere made up of these sort of Platonic elements of earth, air, fire, and water, if you will, you know, the atmosphere, air, the lithosphere, the geosphere, the earth, right? The hydrosphere, the water, ocean vectors. But then there's not really something called the pyrosphere. Of course, that's the biosphere. Life is the thing that burns. And because life is the thing that burns, fire requires those hydrocarbons that only life can supply. And so what we might be looking at when we talk about fire is a planetary, an endemic process to this planet. We have a data set of one. There's no other example. I'm not talking about that fireball in the sky. That's atomic fire. This is combustion. This is something that requires oxygen. Mm-hmm. that requires lignin, or the stuff that is wood, or some sort of hydrocarbon based on some sort of plant matter. You need to have one before the other. And in fact, this is kind of a new thought, but in fact, you know, I think one of the things that is so terrifying about fire is that, and how we describe it is that it seems alive. It grows. It reproduces itself. It dies. It devours constantly, needing to eat just like us. Consume, consume, consume. It's not biologically alive. It's almost like a new domain of life, if we can even build up on that taxonomic diagram and into those ontologies I was talking about, like, and talk about something like ecologically alive. And there might even be, if it turns out that we don't overcome Fermi's paradox, we don't overcome the ability to travel intergalactically, and we don't find any other sentient species or any other, or we don't find evidence of life outside of our own little solar system.